So today is day one of this of my personal project here. I'm going to build a program or an app that will allow me and my colleagues back at the in my office to manage inventory. I work for the government here in Mexico, and basically I am developing websites using WordPress. Still in my free time, I am actually learning from several sites like lynda.com and Pluralsight about Java development, and I may like to work with Android in the future. So at the moment, this is one of the reports that we are going to use here. So it's basically a single table cataloging all the items on the inventory. So this is pretty much the a printed document that will list every single item on the inventory. So as you can see, it's basically just a single table, and we are going to give a quick overview of every field here. So forgive me that this is in Spanish, but I do work in Mexico anyway. There we go. So what do we have here? This is the first column here. It's basically a consecutive number. This is not going to be used in any way or shape or form inside a database or even the application, I think. This is just for the current printed document. It's just a consecutive numbering just for this document here. So it's not going to be used anywhere else. Okay, so this one here is really important. This is the accounting ID of every item. So basically, finance department is using their own system or of cataloging accounting accounts. So they are basically linking every single item on the inventory to an accounting account. So I need to take this into consideration. Basically, I'm just going to be recording this number and whatever system I decide to do. The next one here, this is a really special one. This is an ID number given up by the state government. Right now we are working under the state government. Yet we do have certain freedoms here. So basically, this field here is basically an ID that is supposed to be given from the state government. They do have a web application that is basically it's a really basic inventory system. It's not complex, and the thing with that is that it's not really enough for us to handle our inventory. It's just basically an accounting device just to assign some monetary value to every item, and the CEFI plan is basically this this government enterprise dedicated to finance at the state level. So they are supposed to be giving us an ID number here for every item on the inventory. We don't have it yet, so that's about it. So there is that. Okay, let's there we go. So the next column here, this is going to be my primary key, speaking in terms of databases. This is the ID of our ID to manage our internal inventory. So basically, this is an ID number that is going to be used for our own control. Every item in the inventory is going to have this physical label, and we are going to give it this number here. So as you can see here, We do have a word, a keyword here is IBEC. So that's basically the acronym for the government enterprise here, this one here. It's Instituto Veracruzano de la Cultura. That's that means well, that's about it. Never mind. It's very late, as you can see, and I don't really have that too much energy to be translating here. Never mind. So, description. Pretty self-explanatory. This is going to be a very complex field. I'm not going to be... I'm just going to be saving text here, speaking in terms of databases here. This is going to be an open field. I'm not going to be cataloging this, obviously. So people, users are going to be able to just insert anything there. I'm going to allow them to just put anything there, never mind. So that's just a basic description for the device, for the items. Now here, I'm going to be marking in blue this couple fields here, as you can see. Factura means invoice number. And date is meant to be the invoice date. So every item in the inventory is being purchased from a vendor, obviously. So they give us they are giving us invoices, and those invoices do have some ID numbers themselves. So I'm going to be using those here. The date is basically the date of the invoice. Everything in blue is basically the invoice. And down here, serial number, well, this is basically, this may or may not come in the invoice or on the item, because we can have CPUs, computers, those items do have a serial number sometimes, most of the time. In the sample of chairs, it's depending on the vendor, but most chairs that we have here do not have a serial number. So this is basically, this is not that important. And as you can see here, it can even be empty anyway. So right now, continue with the invoice. It's here, this blue, all these blue fields here. So the first one, it's a monetary value. It's called importe. That's basically the amount paid to the vendor to get the item. So it's basically the price of the item. And the proveedor, that means provider or the vendor. So we are I'm planning to speaking in database terms. I'm planning to do a catalog here. All these vendors are going to be stored in the database, I guess. As you can see, let me see. As you can see here, we do have a couple of items sharing the same vendor here. So basically, this is a good candidate to be a catalog. So basically, I'm going to be storing the providers or the vendors in the database anyway. And the last field here, situation, that's basically just what's the status of the item. I do have something called operativo here. That means it's actually in use, it's operative, or it's an item being assigned to somebody on some place and it's being used. We do have some other statuses here. I don't see them here. Looks like everyone is operative anyway. We do have when the item is no longer of use, either because the item broke, like a chair is broken and we cannot actually really use it. So we declare here in the status, we declare this, we change this status to baja. That means not use or just useless, broken, whatever. So I might like to use perhaps, if not another catalog for these statuses, I may like to use perhaps something called enum, which is basically a short list of predefined options. Never mind that. Let's not get into that quite yet. So this is the first report that we are going to use here. And as you can see here, it's pretty straightforward. From here, many of you, if you do have a database background, you can actually figure out what I'm going about to do here anyway. So let's move to the next one. Where is that? I do have some. Let me see. Let's clear all that. Yes. Just removing some clutter. Okay. So here, what you just saw before this report was the general inventory. We call that the general inventory because it lists every single item on this government agency anyway. But this one here, this is something called resguardo. In Spanish, that pretty much means like a contract that every user is going to sign, and here we are going to list every item from our inventory that is going to be assigned to every employee here. So basically here on the header, let me check something here. There we go. So in the header, we can see here some data here. It's in Spanish, but I can actually translate this. Don't worry. So here we do have information about the user. We do have the name. As you can see here, that's the name is going to be the first. Let me see. Where's the name? There we go. So this is the name. Okay. This is the name. And this is the actual name of the user. So this person is going to be the person that is going to be assigned all the items from the inventory. That's the first thing. Let me see. Okay. So the next value is going to be something called RFC. And that means in Spanish, Registro Federal de Contribuyentes. That means like it's like an ID number that our IRS agency here is using to register this person. So basically, well, that's pretty much it. It's an ID anyway. Here, this is the name. This field is going to be the name of the area or the name of the office that this person is working on. And here, we do have the actual name, okay? And lastly, we have another ID number to identify this person here. It's the CURP. In Spanish, that stands for Clave Única de Registro de Población. That's unit ID number for. Oh, never mind. I don't really know. Whatever. So this is another ID number here. So these two numbers here, they do follow some strict rules. I may not like to get into the work of calculating these values because I don't have to anyway. So I'm only going to store into these fields just a stream value there, and that's pretty much it. I may do some basic validation just to make sure that the length is correct. And perhaps if I when I learn how to use land expressions, maybe I don't really know how they are called, so I may actually validate this data here. Okay, so as you can see here, we do have just to finish the header really quickly, we do have the job title of the person here. This is the job title. This is the department. What else do we have here? The location of the office and the city. Ascription is basically the city where they belong. So that's pretty much it. So we do have some. Oh, well, okay. So we do have some basic information on the top. Here we do have the date of the report, page number, and an ID number for this particular report anyway. So, okay, that's basically it. So here, after some interviews on my job, I learned that all these fields here are not going to be used anymore. So this the report is being created in Excel, Microsoft Excel, so they just leave it there. But the reality is that these fields are going to be replaced by the by another number. Let me see which one is it. All those fields are going to be replaced by by these numbers here, by the accounting account. So basically this number is going to replace all those numbers. Okay, so let's get back. This is from the general inventory file here. So, okay. So all this is going to be replaced by a single field, and I'm not going to be providing that field. The field comes from the finance department anyway. So they need to give us that information here. A description of the item here, date of acquisition, or when did we get that item on the inventory. Color, that's not really used anyway. I don't really know. I'm going to add it anyway, so it doesn't, whatever. Okay, so, and as you can see, you can have a very clear idea right now of what I'm planning to do here. And here we have some repeating fields from the previous report. Invoice number, amount of the item, the ID of the inventory item. This is a barcode, assuming that we are not going to use the same number as the ID. We may need to just insert this here. I'm planning, if we are going to use barcode labels, I'm planning to pretty much use the same number as the ID here, because I don't see the point in using I do see the point here, because the physical label may be read off, maybe stained or destroyed, and we need to assign a new label code. And yet the inventory number is going to remain the same. We are just going to assign it a different barcode number here. Yeah, I guess I'm going to be using this anyway. So what else? Why not? And basically, this is the Cephe plan ID number. This is going to be assigned to every single item in the future. The price at the moment of purchase, and here we do have the statuses: is good, regular, and bad. So basically, those are the three values that I'm going to be using for the condition of the item. And as you can see here on the bottom, we do have some I'm repeating here the resguardo ID number, and here is the signature. Here we do have some signature here from the responsible of the area. This is the boss of the office here. The person that is going to be in charge of taking care of the items. And right here is the person dedicated to the management and record of the inventory. So basically that's it. We do have a basic sum at the bottom here, and that's pretty much it. So those two are the main reports. I do have some notes here in Spanish. So when I was interviewing the personnel dedicated to this, I took some notes, as you can see here. So that's pretty much what I did here. I did some work here anyway. And let me see. So after that, I dedicated a morning to organize my ideas here. Let me show you. We're almost done. So I'm sorry if you are getting bored. So all this is basically just asking people questions and basic analysis, okay? So I'm going to show you here some of my. This is not this is not a UML graphics or entity relationship diagram. Nothing of that. And just this is something similar to a mind map, something like that. That I just created, okay? So this is not going to be used directly as a entity relationship diagram or anything like that. Okay, so basically, here I try to identify some concepts that I'm going to be using in the app, and I try to give it some relationship between them. I'm not specifying what kind of relationship, just to keep my ideas in. Clear anyway. So I listed some entities here, and if I believe that one entity has a relationship with the next one, well, I just created some links here. I'm not going to explain all this. I just wanted to show you because this was my first approach, okay? This was my first approach to the problem. I spent a lot of time doing this one. Okay, so as you can see, there are just a couple of squares here and some lines, and you may like to think that this is not going to take too much time, but it take me around 3 hours just to order my ideas and create this one. Okay, so let me show you what I did next. So here in that was just the beginning. So I decided that this graphic, all this here. I decided to divide it in sections or in parts. Okay? So I created some diagrams that pretty much look like something from an entity relationship diagram. Okay? So basically, here I'm saying that these entities here, like this person entity here, this is the person entity. And we do have some properties here, like the name. The second name and the dir name here, the curve number and the RFC number, and how this person entity is extended here on the employee entity here. And this cloud represents another schema speaking in database lingo. So organigramma is another schema, and from this schema, I'm going to be using a job puesto is basically a job title here. So this is an entity. So basically, a person can be an employee, and this employee is going to be assigned a function, okay? From the how do you call organigram in English? I don't remember. But it's basically the diagram that explains the everyone's job and who's boss from who. Okay? So this is the person diagram, let's say it. I do have another here, the organigram. Okay? So here we can see some something going on here, okay? So basically, on the second report, where the person actually signs and it's the items that he is going to be taking care of, here, ascription is basically the city, location is the name of the building, department is basically just the name of the office, and area is is basically a more specified department assignment. It's basically department, yet and a department can be subdivided in areas. So this is the area entity. So the area entity is going to contain all the department information and all the location information and the ascription information. So, and here, this is the entity that I use in the person schema. This is the puesto, is basically the job title, the job for everyone. So this area is going to contain, I'm not really sure if I should link this here, never mind. But basically, this job title is going to be used in personal to be assigned to an employee, okay? So, and here, I'm getting a relationship between this entity to itself to specify what job is the boss of some other job, okay? So basically, the job title of one person is going to be assigned, and here on this relationship, I'm going to say, well, this job title is going to be the boss of this job title, and so on. Okay, so that's basically it. And just to finish quickly, all this is basically just, let me see. This is the inventory. This is a master slave relationship here. It looks pretty complicated. I try to make it simple, and it's going to be simpler, I guess, in the future. I haven't done anything database related, so this is just an idea. Let me show you the last one here. There we go. So, this schema here is called Bitácora. That means pretty much, this is going to be a log where every single report that is going to be printed out or generated is going to be saved here. So basically, every time somebody prints or generates a PDF for the reports that you already saw, I'm going to generate a query and I'm going to store the master and the detail of those reports here. So basically, this schema is just going to store the generated and printed reports, because in the future, I may like to do two things. One, to reprint the reports from the past, and two, to keep track of all the changes on the printed reports, basically. So this is going to be stored in the reports, and it's just going to be like a log. So I can actually print out the past and see what reports were generated in the past. Is not going to be used for current information, because the schema, the main schema is going to be used to generate the daily work of the app. This is just to have a history recorded here. So that's pretty much what I've been doing here. Okay. So I did some. I tried to, let me see, here. I was thinking about, so what are my abilities here? So basically, I do have some experience, a lot of experience working with databases. I work with Oracle databases, with MySQL, obviously, and MariaDB, Postgres, so basically, and even a little of Microsoft SQL Server 2. So I do have a lot of experience with databases, SQL databases mainly. So my first instinct was to move into a database thinking and begin building a database here. So I did not do that because I believe that was just too easy at this time. And I want to learn Java. That's my main goal here. So I push myself from building the database at this point, because I already know that working on a database schema here is going to take a lot of time. And I'm going to be forgetting the little things I learned watching the video courses on Lynda and on Pluralsight. So what I decided to do was to create some classes using Java to recreate this schema here. So what I did was to create classes. Like, I created in Java the persona class, the person class, and the employee class. The employee class is extended from the persona class. That's still work in progress. Even though I don't have a lot of problem with the syntax creating this, what I did find myself doing was to just create a lot of code that I'm not really sure that I'm going to be using in the future. For example, I began here on the persona class, I began building a lot of constructors that I'm not even sure I'm going to be using, okay? I created a constructor that doesn't require any data, okay? No parameters required. I created another constructor for when the person introduces just the name, just the name. Another constructor with the when I'm using the second and the third name and the first name. Another constructor when I'm using the name, all the names. Oops. When I'm using all these names, plus the corp here, the corp. Oops. Okay, no. And so on. I created a lot of constructors. Alas, I learned how to link constructors, so I'm not repeating code. I'm basically chaining constructors. So chaining constructors is so easy that I find myself doing it a lot. So I created a lot of constructors that basically call another, the previous constructor, and just do something else. So I did do a lot of constructors here. I created getters and setters for my main fields. What did I do? As you can see, the name is divided in three fields here. So I created a method for the persona class to join these three string values into a single one. And that method is basically get full name. So that's basically the method. And the get full name method is going to return the name, the second name, and the third name together in a single string. And using a class called string builder for that. So I'm trying to apply everything I learned on the courses. So I'm really taking a good effort doing that anyway. So I've been working on these two classes here, and I've been doing some experimentation on Java. And at this point, I do not know how to link a Java program to a database and feed these fields with actual values from a database. I don't know at this point how to do that. I do have a course in the way that actually teach me how to link databases to Java applications. I need to study that. I need to finish some previous courses before that. And what else I need to know? I don't know how to create a graphic user interface for my application. So at this point, all the code I'm doing is basically command line programs. So it's good enough to test my the methods I'm building. It's good enough to see if my methods, my constructors are working, if my classes are linked correctly. For testing purposes, it's just fine. Yet at this point, I need to create a graphic user interface and link that interface to these methods here somewhere, in some way. At this point, I do not know how to do that. And yet I do have on Pluralsight, there is a course called Your First JavaFX Application, something like that. So I'm planning on taking a look at that course. I do have my path predefined, so I'm basically trying to master the basics and move on accordingly. And so that's basically it. So tomorrow I'm going to be working on the Java code, and I'm going to be doing another video explaining the Java code, because I'm actually planning to rebuild the classes, or at least remove a lot of constructors that I made, because I don't feel like I actually need too much constructors anyway. So that's basically what I'm doing here. So as you may or may not know, there is going to be well, in the United States, there is already this has been already the Samsung Galaxy S8 and the S8 Plus has been released in America, in the US already. Here in Mexico, I need to wait until May 5, and the 5th of May of 2017 is going to be the release day for the phone here. I'm planning on get it on get that phone. And that's going to be my first Android device ever. So that device is going to be my testing device for the Android applications that I'm planning to do in the future. And I need to keep learning and keep working on that. But I think that Android development is still a long way to go. First, I want to create desktop applications using JavaFX. And obviously connection to databases. Right now, the only course I already finished is the one in Pluralsight called I think it's called Java, the core language, I think it's called, where the person explaining the course is basically teaching me how the what the tools are on the language of Java. What and how I'm supposed to actually use them. Okay, there are a lot of things that are not explained there. Yet I started watching the second course about the core platform, the Java Virtual Machine, and that course is basically showing me how to work with the streams at the moment and how to do actual work using Java, not just the language itself. So I am still learning. I just watched one single course, and I feel like I learned a lot. So hopefully I'm going to be delivering something useful in the future. So I hope to see you here tomorrow maybe. And as you can see here, my videos are not scripted, and I hope that you well, basically I'm doing this for myself, so. So basically I'm doing this for, I don't really think that anybody's going to be watching this anyway. So I'm going to, so my future me, this is what I started working on, and I hope that you had better luck than me at finishing this project anyway. So see you later, man.